If it's good for your mind, well, you can twist and shout. Let it all hang out. Don't you want food? The children of the revolution. No, you want food? The children of the revolution. No, no, no. Oh, no. Well, you can tear a plane in the falling rain. I drive a Rolls Royce, 'cause it's good for my voice. You want food, the children of the revolution. No, you want food, the children of the revolution. No, no, no.
I thought today was a sea of colors, hippies and flower power lovers from around Britain came and congregated around the band in the middle. The police stayed well on the outside of the
to 8 in the morning on the 12th of January 2022, a new year. So I hope everybody had a happy and safe Christmas and New Year's. I'm at Lake Tutera this morning. Stayed over last night, came out here late afternoon after the heat of the sun had backed off a bit. It's midsummer here at the moment, so the middle of the day is extremely hot. Stayed the night last night. Got up early this morning and got the canoe ready. And so this is a perfect situation to film podcast number 50, which I will probably entitle something along the lines of simply Frater Albertus. So those of you who have followed the podcast up till this point will be aware that I just finished a series on the Hermetic Order of the Golden Dawn altar diagrams. And now that that series is finished, I'm going to take a bit of a break from doing long series like that and just focus for a few podcasts on subjects I've been requested to talk about. And so that's why we'll be talking about Frater Albertus this morning. And in particular, I've been asked to talk about the errors in Frater Albertus's teachings. Because anybody who has listened to me talk on my podcasts or read the essays I've produced or my books will be aware that on occasion I talk about my history with Frater Albertus's teachings, and I point out that eventually I discovered that Frater Albertus has made some serious errors in his teaching. Serious errors. And I haven't elaborated a great deal in the past on what these errors might be. So that's what we're going to talk about this morning. Just trying to find a bit of a shady spot to drift in. Now that the sun's just come up behind those hills behind us, don't want to glare out the cameras. Actually testing a new GoPro 9 and a GoPro 10 this morning to see what they are like. So anybody who's interested, I'm filming at 1080p, 30 frames per second. So let's first cover a bit of understanding about Frater Albertus and who he is for anybody who may not be familiar. Frater Albertus was born in Northern Europe, and I can't remember whether it was Switzerland, Sweden, or Germany. I think it was Germany. His birth name is Albert Rydell, and if I remember rightly, he was born in 1911 and he died in 1984. So the important thing about he used the alias Frater Albertus. That's what he published his books under, and that's the name he went by with his students, Frater Albertus. In fact, he called himself Frater Albertus Bagiricus. So the important thing about Frater Albertus is that he had a huge influence on the modern alchemical tradition. Before him, laboratory alchemy in our time was virtually unknown, like the facts about laboratory alchemy. And a lot of people believed that laboratory alchemy was actually a misunderstanding or a lie or just a ciphered occult system to hide an old esoteric teaching on esoteric psychology. A lot of people didn't really believe that laboratory alchemy was a real thing, a viable ancient tradition. And that was largely because before Frater Albertus, there was nobody in public in our time since the beginning of the 1800s, end of the 1700s, publishing books on laboratory alchemy or talking about the facts about laboratory alchemy in public. There really wasn't anybody doing that. So lack of an instruction system caused people to follow what the psychologist Carl Jung said about alchemy, and that was that he interpreted traditional alchemy as a psychological system. And a lot of people were so impressed with what he taught that they accepted that this was basically what traditional alchemy was, that somehow the ancients had a deep and serious understanding of human psychology well before modern psychology recognized it. But this is, of course, is not true. The laboratory tradition is real, and Frater Albertus was the first guy to make that fact public. So that's where we're starting off from, an understanding that Frater Albertus changed the Western occult tradition acceptance and understanding of what laboratory alchemy really is. So we need to go back a little bit in his history to find out how he got himself into that position. So his esoteric journey, as far as his well-known and public teachings are concerned, started off when he joined a Western mystical occult fraternity called the Ancient and Mystical Order Rosae Crucis, which is based in America. The anagram for it is AMORC, AMORC, and it's a very well known fraternity. And he was a student, and I think eventually became a teacher. And for people interested in laboratory alchemy, one of the important things about AMORC is that it taught laboratory alchemy when nobody else really was. But it didn't do it regularly and frequently. It kind of did it in spurts. AMORC actually has a big university and museum in California, I think in San Jose in the US, and so they have classrooms there where they teach courses and different mystical subjects. And so they used to teach laboratory alchemy classes, and Frater Albertus was very interested in these classes and got deeply involved in it. And I can't remember whether he ended up in teaching or was just a student when a problem situation arose where the authorities in AMORC decided to stop teaching laboratory alchemy to their students, as they often did, fits and starts. They would teach it for a while and then stop teaching it, and I'm not sure why that happened, whether it was just they stopped because of a lack of students or whatever, and then they'd start up again when they got enough people who were interested. But Frater Albertus got angry that they decided to stop teaching laboratory alchemy, and got in a huff with the authorities at AMORC and decided to go off and start his own school, which he did in Utah at the beginning of the 1960s, if I remember rightfully. And in those days, his school was called the Paracelsus Research Society. He designed a study course, and I don't know what it was like in the early days, but by the time my teacher got involved in it, it was a 7-year course, and you went back for 2 or 3 weeks once a year every year to learn the next stage of his instruction. So famously, for those people who are aware of Israel Regardi, he was one of the people who got involved in Frater Albertus' school, went and studied there. After years of having a huge influence on the magical tradition, Regardi decided it was time that he actually learned about what alchemy really was, and went and studied with Frater Albertus at his school. But the two of them had known each other from Albertus's Armorc days, because I think they were both members for a while, and they kind of had a bit of a argumentative relationship with each other. I think Albertus wanted Regardi to teach at his Paracelsus Research Society or something like that. Anyway, Albertus kept teaching at his school in Utah all the way through until close to his death in 1984. But some years before he died, he changed the name of his school to the Paracelsus College, and he had big plans at turning it into a kind of alchemical university. But his death intervened and that never came about. So I'm familiar with Frater Albertus's teachings because the woman who taught lab alchemy to me was one of Albertus's students. She was a New Zealander and lived close to where I grew up. And I eventually met her, and she more or less trained me in Frater Albertus's alchemical system, and that's how I became familiar with what Albertus taught and his basic philosophy and his doctrines concerning alchemy. So although I didn't get taught everything she learned in her 7 years at the Paracelsus College, I did get taught most of it, and of course the important stuff, which was Albertus's teachings on the acetate path to the Philosopher's Stone. So of course, while my teacher was instructing me in Albertus's system, and I was young then, in my early to mid 20s, I learned that my teacher was deeply fascinated with Frater Albertus, and most of his students were too. They were deeply impressed with what he understood about alchemy and deeply impressed with the system that he set up to teach alchemy. And a lot of people believe that he was one of the major Western esoteric teachers in history, because of how he changed the landscape of the Western mystery tradition, because of introducing what seemed like serious facts about the truth about laboratory alchemy. So So yeah, my teacher was deeply impressed with him, and of course some of that rubbed off on me. I knew that nobody else was doing what he was doing, and that he had put together a quite extreme study course virtually by himself, and that hundreds of people were signing up for his classes and studying laboratory alchemy. And so he was influencing a whole generation of occultists, particularly people who were interested in laboratory alchemy. And of course all the Armorc students who couldn't get hold of laboratory teaching because Armorc had stopped teaching it, they would go to Frater Albertus. So he had a lot of students who came over to him from Armorc itself. Now, a lot of people who studied under him virtually believed that his understanding of alchemy was infallible, that he knew the key secrets to laboratory alchemy. And this was a big part of one of the reasons why he had such a big influence on impacting people from the magical tradition like the Golden Dawn, impacting their beliefs and understandings about the truth of laboratory alchemy. So for a long time nobody questioned what Albertus said about alchemy, and his system can be summed up very basically that he said that there were three practices or three subject areas of study in alchemy, and that was plant alchemy, which he called the prima, animal alchemy, which he called the secunda, and mineral or metal alchemy, which he called the tertia. And in his 7-year course he taught them in that order, so you didn't get the secrets about the mineral and metallic kingdoms until you got close to the end of that 7-year study course. And I don't know how many people actually made it all the way to the end, but certainly a lot of people made it quite deep into his study. Then after he died, other guys picked up his ideas and ran with them and started up their own schools. And the most prominent example of that is a Frenchman by the name of Jean Dubuis, who started up an organization in France called the Philosophers of Nature. And he hugely expanded upon what Frater Albertus had taught and laid down as instruction for teaching alchemy. So Dubuis himself also made an enormous impact, but he based most of his concepts about what he believed was accurate about laboratory alchemy on what Frater Albertus had taught. So the errors, which I'm getting around to, in Frater Albertus's system were passed on to future generations of students and teachers. So plant alchemy, animal alchemy, mineral alchemy, and he said that each kingdom had a stone that an alchemist could produce, a plant stone, an animal stone, and a mineral stone, and that he attempted to teach how that was done in his school. He also, under his belief that this was how Paracelsus saw things, taught that the anatomy of matter, the alchemical anatomy of matter, all revolved around what alchemists call the three principles, the three alchemical principles, which Paracelsus called mercury, sulfur, and salt. Before Paracelsus, alchemists only talked about two principles, mercury and sulfur, and not a lot of people today, not a lot of students of alchemy today know that. That before Paracelsus's time, whether alchemists knew about the three principles or not, they only talked about two of them. So Paracelsus added to those two the principle of salt and said that there are actually three principles. And Albertus picked up this idea and kind of founded his practical instruction upon how, on a teaching about how you take natural substances like plants, animals, minerals, and metals, and you break them down or retrograde them, reverse engineer them, in order to extract or pull out the three principles which make up all matter. Now, this is a very ancient teaching by alchemists, that all matter is made of three principles. But that's not the end of the story. The problem with Albertus's system was he kind of taught it as if that was the only way to look at the alchemical anatomy of matter, that it could be broken down into three principles. But the ancient alchemists also taught that before the three there were two, and before the two there was one. Getting a bit warm now. And that once you had attained the three principles, the next step in the process was to divide two of those principles into the four alchemical elements. Now, looking back now, more than 30 years after I was first taught Albertus's system, having a lot more understanding and, dare I say, a lot more wisdom now about the system that Albertus was teaching everybody, it seems relatively obvious to me that even though Albertus did sort of talk about the four alchemical elements, I don't think he knew what they really were or how they fitted into the scheme of the practical work. And this is his first mistake, that he only taught to separate things into the three principles and then to purify those separated principles and then to rejoin them back together again. But that actually isn't the traditional customary process. The traditional customary process is to obtain the three principles and then to divide two of those principles in half again, so that we end up with four substances that the old alchemists call the four elements. Detail about what that means and what they are is completely missing from Frater Albertus's system. And that is the first major error that we might recognize about the system that Frater Albertus taught, that also tells us that he actually was not an alchemical initiate, because he didn't understand that important aspect of alchemical teaching. He didn't have the full traditional and ancient alchemical instruction. And again, this tells us that he was not an initiate. What he was doing was he was taking what Armorc had taught him, and Armorc is, with all due respect to those people who love that school and its system, Armorc is a highly suspect esoteric school. I was a member myself at one time, and I would call it the lamest system, with all due respect, that I've ever been involved in. So, what this meant when it came to the process for making the Philosopher's Stone, in fact, the process for making his plant stone and his animal stone as well, is that a major part of his method, his actual practical work, and a major part of the theory he taught was missing. And that means that it was impossible for him to complete the work properly. And this is certainly one of the things that his past students know, and that is that for all his really helpful input and his effect on improving the view of alchemy by the general occult community, nobody could understand why he couldn't complete the work and actually effectively and reliably produce plant stones, animal stones, and mineral metal stones. If his teaching was actually that authentic, why couldn't he complete the work? That was the question. And I can remember back in the day when I joined the school that succeeded Paracelsus Research Society, which was the Philosopher's Nature, started up by Jean Dubuis. I can remember guys who were involved in the Philosophers of Nature who had also been involved in Albertus's school talking amongst themselves, questioning the authenticity and viability of the system that Albertus was teaching. And I can remember, because I was pretty not drunk on the views that my own teacher had about Frater Albertus, but I certainly had bought into the concept that his teaching was virtually infallible and that it was from an initiated source. And hearing those guys talking, there's a huge trout. And hearing those guys talking about whether or not Albertus's system was accurate and viable, and I was just shocked and stunned at what they were suggesting. And I wouldn't actually listen in any detail and give credence to what they were saying. I just wouldn't actually sit down and think to myself, well, let's hear their argument and mull it over. Even though I do remember part of the argument was that the method for the plant stone that Albertus was teaching and the method for his plant work that he was teaching, that there was no precedence for his method in traditional literature, alchemical literature. In other words, it's almost impossible to find somebody else teaching the method that Frater Albertus taught about what the plant work was and how to produce a plant stone. And I had to admit, over the years, I remembered that argument and mulled it over in my own mind, that there definitely was something not right about what Albertus was teaching about the plant stone, and the fact that it was strange that people were finding it extremely hard to make Albertus's method work. And I think one of the reasons was because he was only separating the plant matter into three principles and not also into the four elements, which were then recombined to produce the stone. So this is the second era that Albertus made, and that was his teaching about how to produce stones from plant, animal and mineral works. That his actual concept of what a stone was and how it was produced was very much an error. And I'll explain now why the plant work serves as a strong example of how serious mistakes were made in Albertus's theory and his overview about what laboratory alchemy was. And so in order to explain how his most heinous error came about, we have to talk about a guy called, oh, there's another big trout just surfacing. That was a big trout. We have to talk about a guy called Ramon Lull, which was most people know by its anglicized form of Raymond Lully, who was a gentleman that is guessed lived in the mid 1200s. No one's really sure when the guy lived, because a big part of the argument is that the alchemist by the name of Raymond Lully was not the historical Raymond Lully who was a hero in the Catholic Church in the 1200s. So there was a guy who was a lay preacher in the Catholic Church, and he was a missionary, and he lived in Spain, and his name was Raymond Lully. And his mission was to convert Muslims to Christianity. I think in the end, Muslims got so pissed off with him because he kept going to the Middle East and trying to convince people to stop being Muslims and become Christians. I think they killed him in the end. They certainly stoned him at one point and nearly killed him. So it's said that the historic and Catholic Raymond Lully actually said in his lifetime, and wrote it down and published it, that he didn't believe in alchemy. And so this is why modern academics say that the alchemist Raymond Lully was not the historic Catholic missionary Raymond Lully. But we know, people who are involved in the esoteric tradition are well aware, that in past ages it was not unusual for alchemists to deny being alchemists, especially if they were trained under a secret oath and or worked in a secret society or fraternity of some kind. So to say that someone denied being an alchemist is not proof or even a reasonable argument that they were not an alchemist, because it was common to deny. Anyway, somebody published a bunch of alchemical books, and it is believed that it was around the mid-1200s, and that somebody entitled himself Raymond Lully. And today we refer to him as the pseudo Raymond Lully, and that's a way of saying that it's generally believed that he wasn't the historic guy. Now, the important thing about Raymond Lully is that he lived in Spain and he was practicing alchemy right at a time where alchemy was first beginning to become popular in Europe. Europeans had known about alchemy from the Middle East 150 years before Lully's time, but the practice of laboratory alchemy was not really openly discussed or written about until about the mid-1200s. And Lully was one of the first guys to openly discuss the subject and write about it. And so he wrote quite a few papers. I think they call them books back then, but they were very short. Today we would just call them papers or essays on alchemy. And one of the two of the important things about Raymond Lully is that he was a champion of the acetate path, and he wrote about the acetate path in an encoded language, like a typical ciphered hermetic language. And we don't know whether he invented the cipher language himself or whether he picked it up from some tradition that he was involved in. But the core theme of this enciphered hermetic language was that he talked about the deepest secrets of laboratory alchemy using the language of viticulture, which is farming grapevines for making wine, viticulture, and winemaking. So what he did was he talked about the processes and the substances that were used to make the philosopher's stone, but he didn't name those substances and processes openly. He talked about those substances using an encoded winemaking language. So one of the things that he did, an example of one of the things that he did, was that he talked about an important substance which was the basis of all secret and adept alchemy. And he called this substance the spirit of wine. And today, when we talk about ethanol, or the alcohol that can be distilled off wine, Lully's original cipher terminology is still used in common language in the Western world. We still call it wine spirit. And in Latin, in Lully's time, that was called spiritus vini, wine spirit. So he talked about these chemical substances and processes using wine making language in order to hide these secrets. But common people and other chemists and probably winemakers and people who were students of alchemy, a lot of them believed that what he was doing was actually working on wine, that he was using wine as his main substance. Of course, today we know that's not the case. We know that he was actually using other substances and using the language of winemaking to hide the true names of those substances. So he said that there was a substance that it was at the root of all true and adept alchemy. And he called the substance a number of names, such as spiritus vini, spirit of wine, and aqua vitae, the water of life. And he said that this substance had miraculous properties and could achieve all kinds of magical results in the work of alchemy if you knew what this real substance was and how to use it. So real initiated adepts knew what Lully was up to, that he wasn't talking about wine at all, he was talking about something else. But a whole bunch of other people who were not initiates believed that when he talked about spiritus vini, that he literally was talking about wine alcohol, which is, as I said, why we still use that name for alcohol distilled off wine today, and why distilled spirits, top shelf liquor, is also called spirits. Now, even academics know today that Lowell's Spiritus Vinny was not ethanol, because the things that Lully claimed about his Spiritus Vinny, we know that these things are not true, and therefore it had to be another substance that he was making these claims about. But an entire tradition of chemists, students of alchemy, developed that believed that mucking about with wine and wine alcohol was Lully's big secret. Even though it wasn't a secret if it really was ethanol, because he was talking about it openly. Now we come back to Frater Albertus. When Frater Albertus taught that all physical matter, oh, another big trout, when all physical matter is separated alchemically into its three principles, what he taught was that the mercury principle in the vegetable kingdom was alcohol, ethanol, Spiritus Vinny. And this claim by Albertus can't be found anywhere else in alchemical teaching from traditional times. It was something that Albertus largely made public and rested his teachings about alchemy upon. And what he taught was, you get a plant, you ferment it, it produces alcohol, you take that alcohol and you use it to extract the resins from the plant, and then what you have left is the body of the plant, which could be heated and calcined and reduced to a salt, and that would give you your three principles: a salt, resins, and the alcohol from fermentation. Like I said, I'm labouring this point because it's important, and if you don't already understand these concepts, then it might take you a bit to catch on to what I'm getting at here. The things that Frater Albertus claim to be the three principles of the plant kingdom, and then he transposes those concepts onto the animal realm and then onto the mineral realm. The three principles that he taught for the plant kingdom were wrong. It's true that the salt principle, the alchemical body of a plant, is its calcined salt. But the sulfur principle is not the extracted plant resin. It is not the extracted plant resin. And the mercury principle of a plant is not ethanol obtained through the fermentation of plant matter. The belief by Albertus that ethanol is the mercury principle of the plant kingdom, I don't know where he got that idea from, but it seems pretty clear that wherever he got it from, it was from somebody who misinterpreted Lully's instructions, believing that he was being literal when he was using a metaphor as a code. When Lully said Spiritus Vinny, wherever Albertus got that idea that mercury was plant alcohol, it was from somebody who took Lully's teachings literary. In other words, it was from an uninitiated stream of alchemical study. Either that, or Albertus came to that conclusion himself somehow. Either way, it seems to me, number one, that Albertus taught that ethanol was plant mercury without realizing that there was an uninitiated tradition stemming from Lully's writings that is an error and that it's commonly known to be an error. I believe that Albertus didn't actually know about that. That the alcohol thing was a common and embarrassing mistake. And it basically tells us pretty much accurately where Albertus's system came from. It came from a stream of students of alchemy who were not initiates, who were not real alchemists who knew the real methods. So this is the third mistake that he made, the third error, and it's a serious error, teaching that extracted plant resins and ethanol were two of the alchemical principles from plant material. Wrong, wrong, wrong. And embarrassingly wrong, embarrassingly wrong. So that pretty much ruins his beliefs about plant alchemy. And there's another little addendum to tack onto that. When he taught that there was a plant stone, an animal stone, and a mineral stone, that teaching is kind of a bastardized version of Lully's teaching. Lully taught that when it comes to the philosopher's stone, there were five different ways of producing the philosopher's stone. Five authentic ways, and they are all branch out from the basic acetate path. I know a lot of people don't want to hear that, but it's a fact, and there's historic documents that very clearly point that out to be a fact, both out of Lully's mouth and out of the mouth of other prominent acetate path alchemists, such as Samuel Norton, Norton's father, Ripley. There's a little island over here. I thought that they may have destroyed the island because I was having a problem finding it. Anyway. Number three mistake. Albertus's plant work teaching is based on an embarrassing misunderstanding of Lully's cipher, wine language cipher. Now, number four mistake, which is even more extreme. If you read Hollandus's book, The Vegetable Work, and compare it to other works on the acetate path, it becomes obvious, or at least there is a very good argument to the effect that ancient alchemy, the old, old hidden tradition, was all based on pyrolysis. I'm not going to go into the details of it. I've already explained a lot of the theoretical and some of the practical concepts about this idea, but I teach that ancient alchemy was all about pyrolytic distillation. the pyrolysis of plant material, animal material, and supposedly mineral and metal material as well. That the original tradition of alchemy was all about teaching how to pyrolytically decompose matter, and that out of that decomposition we obtain the two binary pair of physical matter, the sun and the moon, or mercury and sulfur, or the double mercury. Then we obtain the four elements and the purifying and recombining of those elements produces a stone. My understanding of Albertus's mistakes all came to a head and was confirmed when I discovered Hollandus's book on the plant work. And I thought to myself, how stupid had I been myself not applying the acetate path process to plant work and animal work. So yes, it is possible to work on those three kingdoms pyrolytically, and the method for each kingdom is virtually the same. Virtually, not entirely, not exactly, but virtually the same, at least analogically. So the evidence is building for the idea that the original old tradition was actually a pyrolytic tradition, that the heart and core of ancient alchemical teaching is all about pyrolysis. And Albertus did not know this. Oop, shallow water. That's the little island. Frater Albertus had no idea about this pyrolysis of plants, animals, and minerals or metals. So again, that's evidence that he didn't come from an initiated stream. He came from a stream where people were guessing what alchemy was about, and they were taking codes and metaphors literally, and that even academics don't make those mistakes these days. So that's an embarrassing situation. So that's the fourth problem with Albertus being in error about alchemy. That he didn't understand the proper pyrolytic process, and he didn't understand that it was applied to the three primary kingdoms of nature. Even though people around him were aware of books that actually described that. So we can say that no matter how cool we might think Albertus's system is or was, it was hugely lacking, and that there was an enormous amount that he didn't know about. And kind of weirdly enough, there were important figures in the alchemical community back in his day, people like Hans Ninzel, who ran a group called Rare and Ancient Manuscript Society, who were digging up rare alchemical books and transcribing them and producing them for publication. I don't know why, but they were largely keeping these texts to themselves. And then when Hans Nintzel died about 15 years ago or something, in his will, he asked for these books to be dispersed in public online, which has happened. So you can find the entire library of the Rare and Ancient Manuscript Society's books online now, like in torrent files. So Hans Nintzel, for example, knew about Hollandus's plant work and that it was based on pyrolysis, but it seems that he never discussed the situation with Albertus, or if he discussed it with other people and they came to the same conclusion I did, that there is a pyrolytic tradition out there which has gone deeply underground and which very few people are aware of anymore. If some of the people that Hans knew were discussing this concept, it seems that they never made that discussion obvious to Frater Albertus or the people who are working around Albertus, because certainly Albertus, and then it seems Jean Dubuis after him, had no idea about this idea of basing all alchemical work on pyrolysis. So the kind of final statement about all this, which for me puts the seal of authenticity on the concept that there was an ancient pyrolytic tradition and that that was where all alchemical knowledge stemmed from originally, is a book by a man called Johann Weidenfeld. And that book was called The Secrets of the Adepts. And it seems that Weidenfeld, who was writing in the 1600s, was aware that there was this secret tradition. I'm just going to remove my top because it's getting hot. That he was aware of the secret tradition, but he didn't know the actual nature of it. So he spent years doing all kinds of research and talking to all kinds of people who were like seriously into alchemy, people who may know something about the secret underground tradition. And so he eventually came to the conclusion that Lully and the people who followed Lull, or followed in his footsteps later on, were all aware that there was a tradition of pyrolysis and that it was rooted, as Lully said, in the producing of a special substance called aqua vitae, or spiritus vini, or philosophic spirit of wine, and that that substance was the key secret to alchemy, and that you had to produce that before anything else, and then from that all alchemical preparations stemmed, had their source or origin. And this is the theme that Weidenfeld taught in his books, The Secrets of the Adepts, where he revealed publicly for the first time that there was kind of a hidden stream of acetate path alchemists that all knew about the secret substance and that it was the core of secret ancient alchemy. And that, for example, one of these people was Paracelsus, that he knew about the secret substance, and he also spoke about it in a code. He used his own code. And there were other people such as Parcinius, parasinus, however you want to pronounce it, and also DeMonte, the guy who possibly trained Ripley. Ripley knew at least something of the tradition. I don't think he knew the whole scope of the secret pyrolytic tradition, but he certainly knew about pyrolytic alchemy. Guido De Monti, that was his name, possibly the teacher of Ripley, but he was one of the followers of Lully. So we know now with relative certainty, very good argument, that there was this secret tradition, that it was very much underground, that it kind of came close to the surface at different times in history, and that in the present day it's kind of known about, because I unintentionally ended up making Weidenfeld's book kind of commonly known. I transcribed it into a digital format and one of my students dumped it on the internet after being told not to, and then it spread through the alchemical community about 20 years ago. And so there used to be a lot of debate about it, but a lot of people just ignore it now because they can't really work out what it is that Weidenfeld's talking about, and a lot of people just don't want to believe it because they can't figure it out. So here we are, four serious errors that Frate Albertus made that I believe point conclusively to his system being not authentic alchemy. That for all the great benefit that he did bringing alchemy out into the public and getting people interested in it and starting off the process of writing, correcting people's erroneous beliefs about alchemy, the fact of the matter is, as far as I can argue, even though he did this great job of bringing it out into the open, the system that he taught is wrong. It's wrong. Almost all of it is wrong. And so today, the problem with this is that most people who are students of alchemy out there in the public, and particularly online, are people who are working a view which is based on Frate Albertus's teachings. Even if they largely studied the philosophers of nature's lessons, that can also be found online now, Jean Dubois' version of Frate Albertus's work, even if they are largely studying the philosophers of nature version, it's still really rooted in Frate Albertus's views. And those views are wrong. So a huge part of the popular level of alchemical study is not actually alchemy at all. A huge part of what the popular level calls spagyrics, or the spagyric tradition, it's not alchemy at all. It's not accurate. It doesn't produce the legendary results that the old adepts told us to expect from accurate alchemy. That's the final seal of evidence. This fake theory and practice that Albertus established and spread everywhere does not produce the legendary effects that the old adepts told us to expect from authentic alchemical products. That's how we know that there's something wrong with the Albertian and Dubois traditions. They don't do what is claimed of them. And the one important thing about alchemy is that its remedies and their effects are supposed to be extreme. They're not supposed to be like herbalism or making infusions or ointments or salves or extracts from plants that other herbalists and animal product traditional apothecary type systems used to teach and believe in. That's not alchemy. Alchemy is supposed to produce extreme effects. That's the whole point in alchemy. So I hope I haven't stood on anybody's toes, because I'm sure that there are some people listening to this podcast who are not pleased with what I've just said. But the evidence is in the history, and this is something that I really, really press home to my students, that it is absolutely important to study the history of alchemy. Otherwise, it's very easy to make really stupid mistakes. When you know the history, you can see where the errors in people's thinking are who are unfamiliar with the history. So I'm guessing that is probably a long podcast by now. If you stayed with me till the end, thanks for watching and paying attention. Thanks for coming on the paddle with me. And the next podcast will also be another requested subject. I haven't decided which one yet. I have a list of a few that I've been asked to talk about. For those of you who know about Herendon College and the fact that we are doing a beta test of the college system and its software at the moment, I haven't sent a newsletter out for quite a while, so I'm just updating quickly here that the beta test is about halfway through now. Most of the students have completed the first half of the papers, and the head tutor of the college has told me that they could be ready for the next student intake any time, even though the beta test technically isn't finished yet. So we haven't stopped, we haven't forgotten about it, we've just been extremely busy. And of course, COVID and the rubbish that's going on in the world at the moment has caused distraction and a few problems. It slowed us down a great deal, but we're still hammering away at getting the college up and running, and it all looks good so far. I don't have a hell of a lot to do with it these days because it is in competent hands, but it all looks like it's working well. So once again, thank you for joining me in this podcast, and I'll see you again in the next one, hopefully.
if it's good for your mind. When you can twist and shout, let it all hang out. But you want to, the chairman of the revolution. No, you want to, the chairman of the revolution. No, no, no. Oh, no. Well, you can tear a plane in the falling rain. I drive a Rolls Royce, 'cause it's good for my voice. You want food, the chairman of the revolution. No, you want food, the chairman of the revolution. No, no, no.
I thought today was a sea of colorist hippies and flower power lovers from around Britain came and congregated around the band in the middle. The police stayed way on the outside of the we'll be right back.